Hey, good evening one and all, and today we are going to see the session of digging up the past from the tooth. The speaker who is going to present is Dr. Pooja Chakrabarty, and she is a forensic odontologist by profession, and she completed her bachelor's of dental surgery in the year of 2018 with good marks, and she is one of the best outgoing student in her college, I guess. And then one of her quest to do something different, she went on to pursue her master's in forensic odontology. After that, she went for so many international and national presentations, and she went for so many hands-on programs, and she conducted lots of like webinars, and she went for few cases also, which I have here. And then she contributed so many papers related to forensic odontology, and she contributed so many book chapters also. And she is trained in performing dental autopsies also, and dental autopsy in the sense oral autopsies. And she has keen interest for forensic archaeology and forensic facial reconstruction. She is actively involved in the field of forensics and has addressed various talks for graduates, postgraduates, as well as security professionals also. And she has invited as a speaker on various platforms also. And behalf of Savita Dental College and University, CIMATS, we are welcoming you, ma'am.
Thank you so very much for this long introduction. Okay, so should I begin with the presentation now?
Ma'am?
Should I begin?
Yeah.
I hope my screen is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Okay, so we already know this, that we are going to discuss about digging up the past from teeth. First of all, I'm very thankful to Dr. Abhirami for providing me this platform to speak on this topic. This is one topic that I really am in love with. So this heading suggests, digging up the past, that is a part of forensic archaeology, and since there is an involvement of teeth, that is going to come under forensic odontology, or more specifically, it's going to come under paleodontology. So we will be talking about both the sections, and we'll see how are these two fields interrelated to each other. So let's begin with a story. Now suppose that we find a skeletal human remain named as Mr., Ms., or Mrs. X. So now if I have to find from my database who this person is, I'm absolutely clueless, because I know nothing about this skeleton, and I cannot just go to put this entire skeleton into a missing database and find that person. That is not my thing. It cannot ever be done. But on the second part, if I can find out that the skeleton belonged to Mr. X, who is 30 to 40 years old, who probably worked in a glass factory, he's a male, and may belong from the millions. Now I have already excluded a part of the population, and now I am just left with this much information, where I have to look in the database for 30 to 40 years old people who probably worked in a glass factory, so I can have a missing person record from there, a male, and may belong to the northeastern region of India. So this is the purpose of this subject. It's not to exactly pinpoint the person, but to narrow down the search. And even this same principles, the same technology, what we talk about in forensic archaeology, can be very well applied to the crime scene investigations as well. So it's not just about the forensic part that we deal with, the history part. Starting with forensic archaeology, it is the application of your archaeological theory and method to the resolution of the medico-legal and the humanitarian issues. This is the definition given by the Scientific Working Group of Forensic Anthropology in 2013. So the methods it includes might sound very similar to the crime scene investigations method: searching, locating, surveying, sampling, recording, interpreting the evidences, as well as the recovery and the documentation of the human remains. Then we come to the term paleodontology, or even better term, dental bioarchaeology. So bioarchaeology was the term that was first defined by Graham Clark, who was a British archaeologist. And bioarchaeology was defined by American anthropologist. Again, it was redefined, who actually gave the definition of archaeological study of human remains. Earlier, archaeology definitely meant the study of the pottery or the entire culture. It never included the bioarchaeology part. Health, age, sex, and other identifiable factors can be analyzed from the human remains. Bioarchaeology is actually a blend of multiple subjects: paleodemography, paleogenetics, paleodontology, mortuary studies, etc. The analyzing of teeth can be considered as a subfield of bioarchaeology, which might be sometimes called as dental anthropology. Though I deny the fact that dental anthropology is not exactly the same as dental bioarchaeology. Teeth can say for an anthropologist to identify when most of the rest of the remains are already gone. So we know that enamel, being one of the hardest structures, is going to endure a lot of taxonomic changes, and it is going to give us vital information when rest of the soft tissue parts have already gone. Starting with the scene processing method. So these methods are also going to be used in our crime scene methods as well. So it's not just about the forensic archaeology. Human remains can be discovered in and recovered from a very wide range of scene types, be it the indoor type, the outdoor type, confined, dispersed. The location where the human remains are found is often called as a scene or recovery scene. The objectives of a forensic archaeological operation is first to select a detection or recovery strategy which is going to maximize the data recorded and physical evidence recovered from the scene, to establish and fully document the context in which all the evidences are found, to recover all the evidence, and that may be related to identifying the remains, to determine the cause and manner of the death, reconstructing the scene, determining how the remains were deposited, estimating time since deposition, and identifying the post-depositional taxonomic processes to ensure the safe and secure collection, storage, transportation, to maintain the chain of custody. Now, in terms of forensic archaeology, it would mean that just through your documentary and your photographic records mainly. And lastly, to ensure and secure the transport of those evidences to the responsible agency. Beginning with the principal part. So the basic principle that goes into forensic archaeology is called as the Steno's Law, which is actually understanding of stratigraphy, which is the layers of the soil. So the laws are the laws of superimposition, which says that the lower strata must have formed before your upper strata. The law of original horizontality says that the strata which are not horizontal formed, which were later shifted out to their original positions. We can see that, we can appreciate that in the next slide where I have attached those pictures. Law of cross-cutting says that if a burial pit is found in the strata must have formed prior to the burial disturbance. And law of lateral continuity, which says the size and the shape of each stratum is determined by the natural boundary. So here you can see the picture that the upper layer is the youngest layer and the last layer to be formed underneath is the oldest layer. Before the ditch has been done here, the layers have already formed here. The igneous intrusion or any kind of intrusion that happens underneath is younger than the sedimentary type of layer. And before the tilting happens and after the tilting happens, so this is how the layers are placed. Now, what is the importance of studying this? When we are going to retrieve the human remains, we can actually appreciate that at what time probably the human remains must have been deposited out there. Then we start with phases of the archaeological investigation. The first is a systematic search, like we have for our crime scene investigations. The search phase is going to involve locating the area that may warrant further investigation. So you need to identify the area and then you start with a thorough search. So this is going to use the noting down of the features, remote surveying using maps and aerial photography. In forensic context, this will involve a search for the human remains, which is usually the burial feature or the surface remains, even the mass disasters, a mass grave sites as well. In the second phase, we have evaluation of an area of significance. So once a potential area of interest is already located or identified, the area is going to be evaluated with additional investigations now. This evaluation is going to, once your potential area is found out, the area is going to be segregated from the all the other boundaries. The evaluation phase is typically brief and straightforward in your forensic scenario, so that the isolated burial or your surface scatter, because the area of interest is rather small and can be investigated quickly without significantly disturbing the scene. This is the case with your forensic perspective. But when we talk about an archaeological perspective, the land of our interest might be huge. The third phase is your recovery phase, which is a systematic recovery and preservation of the material. So in archaeological context, this phase involves the excavation of the archaeological site and the structures. And in forensic context, this phase involves the recovery and preservation with respect to your evidentiary materials in order to reconstruct the death season, which deposition of the body as well as your taxonomic modification. And the fourth phase is interpretation and the reporting part, which involves the generation of a report and interpretation based on the activities and products. And when we talk about the forensic perspective, this report is going to be submitted to the investigative agencies and provide a summary of the approaches, whatever is used in order to locate and collect the human remains. So starting with the detection methods now, the detection of the scene is going to involve the search and location of the remains. The selection method used in the detection will be huge, because we have to take into account a very big land out here when we are talking about an archaeological section. So when we follow the line search method, it's very mandatory that we have a line leader. We'll see in the next slide. Yes. So when we follow this method, like standing line search, there always has to be one leader who will be responsible to follow the path they are following. So they are following in order to do the tracing. Then we can go through the hand and knees line search. So you're going to just lay down on your knees and then you're going to start with thorough searching. Or we can follow the back and forth line search, where you go over and over again to the line and you do a thorough searching of the area. We can take the help of cadaver dogs, who are specially trained in order to find out the human remains just by sniffing. The plants have their sets of stories to tell. So if we can locate the flora and fauna in that particular area, we can get an idea that there could be something like a, at least if not a human remain, there could be some disturbance underneath the ground that is leading to this change in the flora and fauna, that is a plant. Then we can use the probe method, ultrasonic probe, by which we can just penetrate into the ground. And if we come across anything like this, it's going to radiate the radiations back to the machine and the sensation is going to be captured. Then we have the ground penetrating radars, the GPRs, which works on the same theory. Like the radar waves are going to be sent out from the machine, and once it is are going to touch the surface, the rays are going to go back and the sensations are going to be captured. We can use drone method in order to locate the mass graves in case it's a huge land that we are going to do a survey of. And one of the latest method is LIDAR, L-I-D-A-R, which is a detection and a scanning method. So it can be done surface-wise as well as aerially. So what it does is, it's going to scan the entire area and it is going to uncover even the path that is now already hidden by the other terrestrial or the construction area. Then we have an underwater crime scene or the archaeological scene areas. Now, to be noted is, not many of the forensic archaeologists or the forensic personnel are expert divers. So in that case, what happens is we have to hire professional divers who does dives into the scene space, and they are going to collect the evidences for us. In case, while searching everything, we found out some materials which are completely unknown. Now, we cannot determine whether it is a stone piece or it is a bone piece, etc. We can use the X-ray fluorescence spectrum. geometry method. In this graph, if you can appreciate, the work of this is to determine the elemental composition of the possible skeletal material. So in case you get a calcium and a phosphorus there, you do know that it is at least a biological material and not a stone. So this is how you can rule out. Then we have this particular theory where once a ditch is already dug and a human remain is put into it, that particular part that is going to be filled over is called as the infill. Now, if you notice that there is going to be some amount of the soil that is not going to get into this part again, and it is going to be heaped over on either of the sides, that is called as black dirt. So if you go across this particular surface, you can appreciate a depression along with an immediate elevation. That is what can give you a kind of a signal that there might be something underneath going wrong, and you can do your search out there. We have the screening procedures where we use this kind of handheld sieve, or we can use this kind of hand-supported sieve where we put all the small materials. Maybe we come across smaller teeth particles or smaller bone particles which might go unnoticed when you do a gross search. So we can use this kind of sieve to put off all the soil, and we can come across the crown particle, crown maybe. Maybe a small crown that was missed during the search could be found in this case. Then we start with the recovery procedure. The recovery methods are aimed at removing the evidence from the scene in a systematic manner while maintaining the entire construction area. So it's not that while removing, you can actually destroy the reconstruction value part of it, because in archaeology, our historical evidence value is also related to it. The first step will be to denude the entire scene or carefully to clear the any kind of overburden. As a result of which, now what happens is all your evidentiary value things are going to be clear of any kind of junk. So it will be well visualized, photographed or mapped. The recovery of surface remains is usually simple, as retrieving the items identified and flagged during the search process. Yeah, during the search process, whatever the things you're going to find out, you're going to use a small flag in order to mark that in the position. So in this particular grave, you can appreciate that there were kind of tool marks. Now, I don't say that everybody has to appreciate this because of the fact that while digging up also, there could be some marks. But this was exclusively done by professional archaeologists who could identify the border of the grave, and then they went on to carefully move out the entire thing. So they could appreciate the entire tool marks that was used during the time the grave was dug. Then we have the scene documentation. So the scene documentation will be pretty simple out here, with detailed written notes, photographs of the overall scene, the mid-range views, the close-up views, and we can use videography or the laser scanning also. So this is a technological advancement which will help you to preserve even more evidence. For the mapping part, we are going to actually use a reference, which is a solid reference or a static reference, with respect to which we are going to mark the different bones and the areas. So in the triangulation mapping method, we are going to use the angulation in order to mark the reference point. And in the trilateration method, we use distance instead of the angle. So this is the only difference between your triangulation and your trilateration. The purpose of this is when you are going to take out these biological samples, at least you'll have a reference in your map that it was found at this position, and this will help you to join the dots and form the reconstruction theory. While doing any kind of excavation work, generally what happens is this kind of excavation comes up, the human remains comes up while constructing the modern day construction. So use of these kind of heavy materials like your JCB trucks, these are very common, but ideally you should not be doing it. In case if it's a huge land that you have identified, the gross excavation can be done using your JCBs, but while the construction is going a shorter or a narrower range, you should be using this kind of proper archaeological tools, that is your small brush, your compass, tape, string, any kind of measures or kind of handheld shovels, so that you can preserve the entity or the integrity of the bones underneath. do not forget that the samples you are looking at is already quite old. You even don't know how old are they. So if you try to give them strain or stress with more amount of instruments, that will lead to its complete disintegration. Now we come to the evidence collection and the packaging part, where the human remains and the associated evidence are going to be collected. They are going to be properly packaged in a manner that the preservation of the integrity is to the maximum, and an inventory needs to be maintained so that all the items are taken note of and are preserved properly. So the general procedure will be to cleaning up of the entire remains, separation of what is of your interest, separation of human and non-human bones, and you have a separate bone and a tooth inventory. So after you have done this, then you can start with your data collection. And in case you come across the samples which are completely segregated from each other, you can always use this kind of a temporary fixation method so that you have the entire bone in one piece. Paleodontology specifically is a subject which is a study of teeth and associated oral structures through skeletal or your fossil remains. It has a variety of information to provide to you: your dietary patterns, history of pandemic, dental culture, migration history, age and ancestry, teeth being used as a tool, and paleogenomics. So let's see one by one how are these happening. Before that, what is the importance of teeth? Now, I'm not going to go over and over again about it's stable, it's reliable. Most importantly, it is extremely valuable because they are exposed directly to the environment we live in. So anything that we consume or breathe actually comes directly in contact with the teeth. And again, it is a hard structure, so it is difficult to wear it off, and it gets preserved pretty well over the test of time. Few revolutionary findings in respect to your teeth and your archaeology. In few famous cases, the work of dental bioarchaeologists has changed the way we thought about the past civilization. So for example, the burial site near your Stonehenge contains the remains of Beaker people who were members of a group who lived around 2000 BC. Isotope analysis of their tooth enamel helps to reveal the details about their migration. The evidence showed that they most likely traveled to Stonehenge later on in their life. And the analysis of dental evidence from Pompeii had indicated that these people had a very healthy, tooth-friendly diet, as their teeth were near perfect condition, better than the people who are living today. So these are the few things that were considered as revolutionary findings back then. Now we come to the core part related to forensic odontology, and we start with the ancestry and teeth part. So we do have an idea that the skull shape and the dental traits of human remains differ. Those of different ancestry. For example, your European ancestry differs from those of an African ancestry in terms of your skull structures, be it a longer, narrow face, sloping eye orbits, etc. I'm not getting into the details of this part. So how to determine ancestry from your dental parameters? An example of this can be your non-metric teeth trait, which can be a valuable asset in determining the ancestry of the remains. So we have the Asugarh block, Arizona State University block, or we have the Turner Scott block, which has different kind of grading for different dental traits. After that, we can use the shape and size of the teeth as well. So if there is a proper population-based study based on intercanine width or your incisor index or your intermolar distances, we can use those values in order to determine the probable ancestry of the human remain that we find out. And apart from this, we also have the palatal forms, the orbital form, the mandible, chin projection, chin form, which can give us a brief idea about what kind of ancestry are we looking at. Now, when we talk about the age of a human remain, so there are two questions we need to answer when we find out a skeletal remain. What is the age at the time of death? And what is the age of the specimen since the time of death? So these are two questions. A person might have died at 20 years old, but since that time till today might be some 50-55 years have passed. So these are two questions, and two different methodologies are applied in order to answer these four. For the age at the time of death, you already know about these methods, at least in brief. So from the teeth, we can use the Sylvian eruption patterns, or your radiographic, biochemical methods, or the histological methods, whatever you like. You can use these methods to find out the time, at the time the person was dead. But when we need to find the age of the specimen since the time of death, we need some even more complicated methods, like your relative dating, absolute dating, stable isotope analysis, the carbon 12, 13, 14 dating, your AMS, that is your atomic microscope spectrophotometry, nitrogen 14 analysis, uranium analysis, and your ash analysis. So briefly explaining to you the process of carbon dating, when a bone is excavated, it is completely clean. A very small sample is going to be taken and ground into a fine powder-like piece. Further treatments with your weak acids are done, and it is freeze-dried. A series of chemical reactions are used to convert all the carbon atoms present into benzene. Formation of benzene occurs, addition of scintillator to the benzene sample, liquid scintillation spectrophotometer counts the number of decays that occurs per minute, and the computer analysis data is going to give you the date of the sample. So it looks like a very simple process, but trust me, it's a very complicated and expensive process. So not everybody has this kind of a setup to do this, and that is the reason why archaeological samples are treated at specialized labs. Then we have the dental wear and dye. Like we know that the mammals have four different kinds of teeth. So the pattern of teeth can actually give us an idea about what kind of dental habits, eating habits did they have. So if the canine is going to be worn up too much, it probably hints at a carnivorous diet. If the grinding molars are a broad-shaped one, so it could be a herbivore that you're looking at. Wear and markings on a specific area of the teeth can help us to figure out what exactly the person or the population was accustomed to eating, or the normal wear and markings may indicate a diet predominantly consisting of your meat. So now we can see in this particular graph, this is about stable isotope analysis, where the graph range is going to show you what kind of diet did these people follow. So something in between, say, minus 21 to 19 shows it was the agriculturist population, which comprises of your carnivore, omnivores, herbivores, similarly a mixed marine culture as well as your marine mammals. So what happens is, isotopes are the atoms of the same element which have an equal number of your protons and unequal number of your neutrons. So they are divided basically into two categories, radioactive and stable. Radioactive are the ones which are going to decay over the period of time. So they are helpful for the dating of the archaeological finds. But stable isotopes are the one which is not going to decay and have a relatively stable nucleus. So they are the one who has other applications in archaeology. Why are we analyzing these kind of isotopes? They are present literally everywhere in the world in which we live. But the balance of the ratio is what differs in identifying of the diet introduction. So as we grow and continually grow, we have different growth phases. So this is how different amount of isotopes are registered into that particular development part. So by measuring the ratios of different isotopes in the bone or teeth using specific scientific knowledge, so you can find out about many things about an individual, like their diet or the environment they grow in. So stable isotope analysis is basically helpful for your diet analysis and your migration pattern analysis. The different isotopes that are used are carbon isotopes, nitrogen, oxygen, strontium. They all have different evidentiary values. Now talking about teeth and health. So we all know that dental disease is nothing new. It was there in the past as well. In terms of caries, when the industrial population started and with the introduction of your carbohydrate diet, the caries was increased at that time. So Similarly, the gum disease was one of the commonest examples even then, and not much could be linked with your diet environment. So we can see this particular picture where you can see enamel hypoplasia visible on the front teeth. So you can actually relate about the deficiency diseases that happened back then. Then we have this kind of a significant age-related diseases in the antemortem tooth floss, caries, calculus, etc., even your adhesion. This kind of abscess or your attrition can be helping you in finding out or reconstructing of the history there. Then we have paleogenomics, which is actually a biomolecular treasure hiding in plain sight. Now, this is quite a nascent field, and most importantly, it has a very long way to go starting now. Teeth has always been used as a matter of DNA analysis because of the position of the DNA. It is very well preserved within the teeth structure. But results were revolutionary when Christina Wardiner and her colleagues started to analyze the calculus as well. So calculus being a sticky plaque entraps everything. And fortunately for those paleogenomic researchers, they preserve as much DNA as our teeth did for millennia. So it revealed a lot of things about the person staying there and about the population in study. DNA from the tartar was preserved on the teeth of ancient skeleton, which revealed the consequences of changes in the human diet, health from the stone age to your modern day. So this actually held a lot of information than we could have expected. Now you can see in this picture that it belongs to the same skeleton, but the calculus formation on the right side, while the left side was not at all affected. So it could raise a question like what exactly must have happened that this kind of a pattern was observed. Similarly, heavy antemortem tooth floss, and you can note a healed fracture on the right side of the maxilla as well. Now talking about the dental jewelry, which is one of the forms of self-expression. So according to the recent analysis, teeth examined from the collections in Mexico's National Institute of Anthropology has shown ancient people of the southern North America went to dentists to beautify the choppers. The different kinds of jewelry that were used were tooth gems, twinkles, rings, dental tattoo, dental grills, etc. Each of them held a different importance whenever it was there. So in this kind of a Japanese woman, we have in the next slide as well. So we can see even the dental modifications, which is a result of your clay stem pipe or using teeth as tools in place of your scissors, pliers, etc. So these kind of modifications are not just for the cultural purposes, but as a result of your occupation sometimes as well. This is a sample from your Mayan culture, which is still date considered to be the most complicated artistic population in record because of their choice of the dental structures they had. So the inlays that was used back then were made out of jade, pyrite, very precious stones, and the way the dental treatments were done at that moment was something that actually raised a lot of questions back then. Then we have the teeth staining methods where these Ohoguro people of the Japanese custom, they used to completely stain their teeth in black. And they actually thought that it was making them physically attractive. And not only that, they used to be helping in preventing cavities and gum diseases. Similarly, the process of dental etching and filing off of the teeth was very common in the remains of your North America, Mesoamerica, Europe, Africa, and Asia. Grills started out as a fashion statement for the hip-hop community. Now, even before this girl patronized this kind of an ad, teeth was being used as a tool since very long. So mostly, it is an activity-induced dental modification because of your mouth acting as your third hand. So Baikal case study of your hunter-gatherers actually reveals that the teeth they were using for shelling of teeth. So whatever the fish they were taking, they used to shell the skin of the fish with their teeth. So this kind of activity where they used to make tools with their teeth. So these were the findings that was epoch at that moment. The studies of groove locations and the longitudinal polish type stones helped in documentations of these kind of evidences. Now we have teeth as an evidence to pandemic. So we do know about Hutchinson's child, where we do see the mulberry molars, which is a very prominent sign we see in the teeth. These kind of signs are an example that the epidemic or the pandemic had existed even back then. And they had forced the people to make some very epoch-ending changes. So there are few diseases like the viral ones, HIV, and before some time, even COVID-19 was considered as one of the viral diseases which did not cause any kind of a bone-related disorder because they are going to kill a person quick enough. So in that cases, the soil analysis or the DNA analysis of the pathogens could be helpful. But very recently, from the recent articles, we can even come to a point that COVID is also leading to the changes in your alveolar bone patterns, and it could be found in the later generations maybe. Then we come to the evolution of dentistry and how did the treatment, the instruments, everything evolve. So from the specimens, we could see that gold was actually drilled into the tooth canals. Similarly, the evolution of the toothbrushes from when it started and till what we have, the orthodontic treatment, the different kind of crowns they use, the dental treatments they use, the different kind of patterns or the fillings they use. So these were all the things that was helping us to recreate history once again. Newer species of ancient humans were then again discovered in Philippines, dubbed as Homo luzonensis, based on the patterns of your 7 teeth and 6 small bones. So this was something. Then we have the occupational changes, like we already know about the tailors. They have a tendency to hold the needles with their incisors. So we can do expect that the incisors will have some kind of changes, which we can relate it to the occupation. Now we have just a few case studies, the first being that of Ajnala, where the recent discovery of the remains of 100 soldiers was happened in a well-like place. Ajnala is a place in Punjab. So what they did is they took care of all the skeletal remains and they analyzed the age of those remains, and they could relate it to the 1857 revolt, the soldiers involved in that. Then we have the Annigiri skull case, where because of a heavy construction, all these skulls were popped up and the analysis were made. And with relation to your forensic case, we have the Sheena Bora case, where the skeletal remains were found in Raigarh, Chhattisgarh. And those remains could actually not be preserved because of the techniques that were used in order to excavate the remains. So what the moral of all the entire session is that we need to have a good knowledge about forensic archaeology in order to carry out a good excavation and preserve the evidences that we have. So in India, we do have an overburden of cases. So the cases which are more than 17 years old, that can be actually given to the bioarchaeologist instead of the police people. And since it's a budding scheme, it has a good scope in the future, and a lot of research can still take place with relation to paleogenomics and paleodontology. These are the few studies that have already been done regarding the diet in the Gujarati people, as well as analysis of your radiocarbon stable isotopes and the DNA in teeth. That's all for my presentation. I hope I could make sense to everybody. Thank you. If there is any question, I'll be happy to take that.
Done with the session today.
Thank you so much. I just hope it was in place because it was too much, I believe, like the two subjects in one slide.
Yes. So this is your participation and certificate from my side.
Thank you so much.
thank you for the time, and you have prepared lot.
Yeah, I think so. I did not realize this while I was preparing it, but now it definitely makes sense after speaking for such a long time.
Yeah, ma'am. I think few questions are there, so we'll go. I'll see any questions are there.
I don't think there are questions. Yeah, but thank you so much, participants, for being there with me for such a long time.
And still we are using the carbon dating, the thing. Still
we do use.
Because yes, it's like a huge process, no?
Yeah.
Still we are going for the carbon dating everything.
We do that. We definitely do that. Like, we have centers in Bhabha Atomic Research Center. So there are very few labs in India which are specialized for this activity because of its cost and the equipment setup.
Then I think that's all. There is no questions. So yes, done for the day.
Absolutely.
We'll meet you soon. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your time and
thank you for your lot
for the session. And soon we'll see with some other webinars.
Absolutely.
I think within some 10 to 15 days, we'll meet you again. And I'm thanking you so much.
The pleasure is all mine, and thank you for your invitation and your time, because I believe you were too busy, but finally it just happened somehow.
It's like,
so anyways,
full engaged. Full still now I'm engaged. After this also I have few works to do. I have to finish that.
Being busy is better than being like doing nothing. So that's a better option.
The college administration is keeping me, like making me to be busy.
That's great. You'll have some other things to add into your resume later on.
I have to thank my dean and my academic head, Deepak Nalaswamy sir, for this. He's one of the most, I never seen a person like him. He's the one of the best supporting sir I have ever seen in here. Like in my whole college days, like UG, PG, everywhere. But
definitely he is quite enthusiastic, definitely.
And our dean also, I don't want to say about my dean, who was such a wonderful woman. She's handling everything like a good way, and she is one of the supporter to our things.
No, that's excellent to hear that at least there are people who are supporting this school. So this is how we finally expect to grow all over.
Yes.
There has to be somebody to take that initiative. So definitely all you people are doing a fabulous job in this respect.
Okay, we'll meet you soon.
Yeah. Thank you. Bye, take care.
Bye, take care.